Hello, good evening. Welcome to everybody to this webinar. It's a Fujifilm webinar hosted by the ESGE. And we have a very, very interesting program this evening. We have new technologies in endoscopy and very exciting and very competent and good speakers. And I'm really excited to chair this webinar together with Cesare Hassan, my dear colleague from Rome. Hello, Cesare.
Hello, Oliver. Great to be with you and with all our friends.
Hello. So we would like to start this webinar to just introduce the new Eluxio artificial intelligence system, the cat eye system from Fujifilm, which is very exciting. And you can see on the next slide how the system works. So this cat eye system has a detection mode, you can see on the left side, and it works with white light endoscopy or LCI, link color imaging. And so you can do your colonoscopy as you would like to do. And then when you pull back, and then the AI is on and detects polyps, as you can see in this image. And what you can do then is, after you detected the polyp, you can switch to BLI, and then the cat eye system starts the characterization mode. And then you have a real-time characterization of the polyp and tells you whether it's an adenoma or a hypoplastic polyp. What do you think about that, Cesare?
I feel that there is a lot of excitement in the community about the artificial intelligence. I feel it is a surprise for everyone, Oliver, to have suddenly bought detection and characterization mode on the same instrument. We have great speakers, but I also want to know the feedback by our audience by using the chat function. But let me say something, Oliver, next slide. For those who love the Eluxio technology, this is a very well integrated AI system because it works on the same monitor with all the 700 series. So basically, Oliver, you only need to plug in and then you continue to work with the Eluxio as you are doing. Before, Oliver, I leave you with the great program. Let me thank on your and my behalf Fujifilm for a long-standing partnership with our society, the ESGE, and for the privilege Fujifilm gave to us to host such an innovative webinar. And stay tuned, there is a lot of things coming out from this webinar. So Oliver, back to you for the program.
Thanks, Cesare. So let's start with the first speaker. I think I don't have to introduce him, but I will do. It's Professor Helmut Neumann from Mainz, and he's a very well-known expert in endoscopy. He's really very excellent scientist, and he talks about the adenoma detection rate with LCI and AI, so the new artificial intelligence systems. So Helmut, we are excited that you're here with us and really looking forward to your talk.
Yeah, Oliver, thank you so much. And also I have to thank the ESGE and Fujifilm for this great opportunity giving this talk here in the afternoon about the highest adenoma detection rate with LCI and AI. And Cesare already mentioned, and you of course as well, that today we have the great pleasure talking about the new technique of Fujifilm, which is called CAT eye. And CAT is the name for computer assisted diagnosis. And in this session today, you will see that we have now a CE mark device for both detection of colorectal polyps, but not only for detection, but also, and I think this is really extremely exciting for us, also for characterization. So I would say we can start with a presentation. And about the highest adenoma detection rate with LCI and AI. And you see, I'm a medical doctor, but I'm also trying my best to improve my skills during those COVID-19 times for music. So I hope you like it. So, and then we can go to the next slide, please. And afterwards, I think I have control about the presentation by myself again. Perfect. So I think we have a specific challenge at the moment in endoscopy. And this specific challenge includes both the detection of colorectal lesions, but also, of course, the characterization of colorectal lesions. So within the recent years, we have learned a lot about advanced endoscopic imaging techniques, and we have learned a lot about how they can improve our daily routine clinical practice, specifically regarding detection of lesions. So the question is, what can we now expect during those days on advanced endoscopic imaging techniques? And the first one is that we can expect both increased detection and characterization by using different lights. And this was really a very big advantage for us in endoscopy that a couple of years ago, Fujifilm introduced LED light sources for endoscopy. So, you know, traditional endoscopes were using xenon light sources, and xenon light has three light spectra covering the green, the blue and the red light spectrum, but with the LED system, we have an additional light, which is blue-violet. And this yields in a very good, intense characterization of the mucosal surface pattern morphology. So the mode for this one is called LCI, and LCI is linked color imaging. And you can see we have very similar to xenon light, red, green, and blue, but we have an additional color, which is blue-violet. And LCI, what we have learned over the past years, is that everything in the endoscopic image, what appears white, is a little bit more whitish, and everything what is red appears more reddish. Therefore, we are able to identify specifically those flat lesions much more better in the theory. I will show you the studies in a couple of minutes. But most important also with the LCI mode, that the natural color remain the same. And this is extremely important even compared to traditional optical chromoendoscopy techniques. You know, they are changing the illumination here and the color of the tissue, and therefore it's very, very difficult for us as endoscopists performing many procedures with it, with these light changing techniques every day. So what we have learned, and this is a study published in Gastrointestinal Endoscopy in 2017, that LCI indeed yields in an increased detection of colorectal lesions. And this was a multi-center crossover prospective randomized controlled trial. So one of the best study designs we can choose for endoscopy, comparing white light endoscopy with this LCI for detection of colorectal polyps in 152 patients. And in this study published in GIE, we have seen that with LCI, we have an overall polyp detection rate, which is increased by 24%. 23% of patients were detected with more polyps. And also, there was a significantly higher per patient adenoma detection rate. So another study published 1 year later in endoscopy, and this was also a landmark study for us, has shown that LCI reduces the miss rate of neoplastic lesions in a randomized tandem colonoscopy study in the right colon. So the right colon is of paramount importance for us because we know from various studies published over the past years that we are specifically missing lesions in the right colon. But with LCI, in this randomized tandem study, including over 600 patients, it has been shown that the adenoma miss rate was really significantly less by using LCI compared to standard white light endoscopy. So this is LCI, this is linked color imaging. And then maybe you want to ask us, why should we use artificial intelligence now? What is the reason to use AI? Why do we need something more? And this is one of those explanations, because we have learned that advanced endoscopic imaging, although extremely effective in expert centers, in studies, well, it's not that much effective in the community practice. And this study published in gastroenterology, including 13 gastroenterologists who were trained for real-time optical biopsy of colon polyps with optical chromoendoscopy, well, you can see that only 25% of the colleagues were able to assess polyps with a greater than 90% accuracy. So the PV thresholds proposed by the American Society for Gastrointestinal Endoscopy were not met in most cases. So therefore, concluding that although the studies for experts are showing that advanced endoscopic imaging is effective, it might be not that much effective in the community practice. And in this context, of course, the question for us is, what can we now do in order to make it more effective? And for sure, we should use computers. And of course, we should maybe not use this old hardware. This was, by the way, my first computer I've used, so-called PC1, a couple of years ago already. But of course, we should use artificial intelligence or CAT. And CAT is computer-assisted diagnosis. And computer-assisted diagnosis, in my opinion, doing endoscopic research now in advanced imaging techniques now for more than 15 years, I would say this is really a very new, extremely exciting breakthrough for all of us. Because the new system we have now, and this is from Fujifilm, and this is a system overview. This is that we have a very special system composition, and Cesare already mentioned it. We have the traditional video processor, and we have an additional expansion unit called X1. This is fully compatible to any 700 colonoscope, so when you're using Fujifilm, you can use it with the 700 systems, and no additional monitor is required, what we feel is of paramount importance. And most important is that we have a CE mark device now, which is approved for both colorectal polyp detection and colorectal polyp characterization. And in addition, it includes a movie recording function. So the system is enabled by just pushing a button on the handle of the endoscope, and you can see that we have three different modes, one dedicated to detection with white light, one dedicated to detection with LCI, and a third mode, and you will hear this in the topic after mine, this is about colorectal polyp characterization. So the cat eye, and this is extremely exciting for us, is totally different to other competitors, providing detection systems, because we have a specific graphic user's interface for the detection. And this one is shown the detection box, and this is normal. So the area where the polyp is thought to be detected. But in addition, we have a specific detection sound. So it beeps when a suspicious polyp is detected. And we feel this is extremely exciting for us in the practice. And in addition, and this is also very exciting, we have a visual assist circle here surrounding the endoscopic image, lighting up in the direction where the polyp is detected. So you can see the polyp is detected here at the 5 o'clock position, and your visual assist circle is even highlighting here the area of the polyp at this in between 6 to 3 o'clock position. So it helps you in order to identify the polyp. So I want to show you an example here of the so-called Lely system, so the cat eye of Fujifilm for real-time detection. And this is here in the in retroflexion. And we are sorry for the delay, but you can already hear the detection sound, so the peep sound. And then next, you can see the detection box. And I'm sorry again for the delay here, according to the streaming. But you can see that although we have a lot of residual stool components in the colon, the detection box is only specifically highlighting the polyp, and again, with a detection sound. So another example, I feel this is also very exciting. This is showing, you can see here the sound, and then you can see the detection box here. And no visual assist circle because the lesion is located at the 6 o'clock position, so directly in front of your eyes, so you do not need any visual assist circle. Another example, what is extremely important for us is in the right column. You can see the ileocecal valve, and you can hear the detection sound, but you're not able to see the polyp at the beginning. But then when you're going back, indeed, you can see that there is a large polyp located behind one of the folds here in the cecum or in the right colon. And this is indeed a polyp which might be easily missed, although it's a large polyp, but because it's close to the fold, so maybe a little bit hidden. And also another example, and again, we have to apologize for the little bit of the delay here of the streaming, but I've learned there is a lot of participants today. So excuse that the internet connection may be not that fast, but again, you can hear the sound. And then you're wondering where the polyp is. And this is also something what is extremely exciting for us to recognize, that the cat eye machine is also detecting not only the traditional polyps, so not only the traditional adenoma, but cat eye is also detecting sessile serrated polyps and sessile serrated lesions. And this is extremely important for us, because here again, the right colon, you can imagine the ileocecal valve in the back and a large sessile serrated lesion. But again, this lesion is detected here by Lely by cat eye with detection mode here in combination with LCI. And the question, of course, for us is, what about other indications? And again, you can see here in this example, now the visual assist circle lighting up in the upper direction, showing you that there is a polyp, and you're moving a little bit the scope. And then again, you can see this is a little bit of residual adenoma after previous polypectomy. So there's a traditional polypectomy scar, but even the cat eye machine works here in this scarish tissue. You can identify the residual neoplasia even close to the scar, and then you can perform adequate endoscopic therapy. So is it now effective to use cat eye in combination with LCI? And indeed it is. So we have presented these data early this year by evaluating the combination of cat eye with LCI for detection of colorectal polyps and also sessile serrated lesions. And the cat eye machine was trained for colorectal polyp detection first using a data set of fully anonymized videos, and then for the validation, 240 polyps within fully recorded endoscopy videos were evaluated. So what we have learned from this study, that the sensitivity, so the true positive per frame per lesion rate was 100%, so no lesion was missed in this study. So the calculated false positive frame rate was far less than 0.01%, and also, and this was a major breakthrough for us to learn, even doing endoscopy studies now since so many years, that LCI cat eye detection rate for sessile serrated lesions was also 100%. So in this study, 36 sessile serrated lesions were included, but none of them were missed by using the LCI cat eye detection mode. So in conclusion, I feel what we have learned now is indeed we have something what is extremely exciting for us. It's extremely new and it's CE approved. So we can already use this in our daily routine clinical practice. We have learned that the cat eye allows for detection, and you will see later on even for characterization of lesions in the colon, and the device is CE approved. LCI cat eye achieved 100% sensitivity per lesion and an negligible false positive frame rate. And also, and this is what I personally like very much, because this is something what we have missed in previous studies, that we have a 100% detection rate of sessile serrated lesions by using this LCI cat eye detection mode of Fujifilm. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Helmut, for this great talk and those exciting studies you showed. I'm very impressed by the high sensitivity and the really the great results. Also, you also showed that the system is able to identify and to detect those sessile serrated lesions, which are quite difficult sometimes even for an experienced endoscopist to detect. So what do you think, Cesare? What's your impression?
So it's very interesting, and there are already a lot of questions for you, Helmut. And fortunately, the questions are for you. So my point, Helmut, just imagine that I did a lot of effort in the last 10 years to improve my ADR, okay? Now I spend 6 minutes of withdrawal, I have a high definition endoscopy, I have LCI, and my ADR is quite good. So my ADR, for instance, is 50% in fit positive. Why should I use CAD eye? And secondly, Helmut, and this is more difficult, okay, because this also come not only from developed but also from developing countries. Is this system affordable for all the community endoscopy, or is something only for a expert center, creating a fracture in between what you have in a expert center as yours in Mainz and the remaining endoscopy community in Germany? So Helmut, can you try to address these 2 points that come from our questions?
Yeah, thank you. And thank you for asking those questions. First of all, I really believe this is a system which should be affordable by everyone. and because it helps everyone. Of course, you're right. We have individual adenoma detection rates ranging between 15% to 60%. This is extremely challenging for everyone to interpret. However, I personally feel this is something what is new. You cannot compare artificial intelligence to endoscopy systems we have introduced in the past years, like LCI, for example, because this is now a system which is really only based on computers, so computer-assisted diagnostic imaging modality. And personally, I feel that indeed navigation systems in the car, you know, so they're available for every new car you're buying. And I feel this will be the same for endoscopy systems. So when you're buying a new system, the CAT eye will be included in this because it will help you. Even in your car without a navigation system, you know, from Mainz to Rome, I will find my way. But maybe this way will take me a couple of hours more than by using a navigation system. And I would feel this is the same for the CAT eye machine. So first of all, it is affordable for everyone, and it should be affordable for everyone. So everyone should use in the future artificial intelligence because it will help us improving our routine clinical practice. And what we also learned in the studies, and maybe you agree, Cesare, because you are the expert in this specific field and you have done so much work in this, you know, so it's even depending on the time, you know. So in the morning, when you're very good relaxed, the polyp or adenoma detection rate may be different, like in the evening or very late afternoon, especially when you have done many procedures. And even this is totally dependent from countries to countries. And this is something where even AI will help us. So not only in the morning when we are very good awake and we detect every polyp, but even in the late afternoon and in the evening. And this is something where I would consider always to use AI.
Thanks.
Very good. I think that's a very, very good answer for that. And I like the comparison with the car. So I always make the same comparison. I say when you buy a new car, you have all those safety assistants in there and you can a very good driver, but you feel better when you know that somebody is looking with you together on the street and perhaps starts the braking process a little bit earlier than you. The same is when you're tired. As a very good endoscopist with an ADR of 80%, of 60%, then you might also miss a polyp because you're tired, you're distracted, and then you have a always awake a second pair of eyes looking together with you at the endoscopy images.
Yeah. This is very important, Oliver, as much as please don't drink beer before you drive or before you do endoscopy, okay? Especially when you pick up your passion. Helmut, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Great talk as usual. And
thank you.
See you later. Okay, Oliver, I feel that now we can move to the second talk. So Oliver, I guess that most of us know Emanuele for because he was a champion in small bowel endoscopy, but now he moved to large bowel endoscopy and he's again a champion and he already did great things in the field of characterization and I, and of course, I'm extremely proud of him because he's from our country. So please, Emanuele Rondonotti, polyp characterization and then discussion.
Everybody, good evening to everybody. Thank you, Cesare, for the nice introduction. My talk will address the polyp characterization from BLI to the AI. First of all, I would like to thank Fujifilm for the kind invitation and also the ESGE for hosting this very interesting meeting today. Why are we addressing this topic today? Because as we heard just before, by introducing new technologies such as polyp characterization, such as virtual chromoscopy, LCI, many other systems, the number of polyps that we are able to detect during regular colonoscopy is steadily increasing. And among the polyps we are identifying, the number of small and diminutive polyps is still increasing. As we can see here in this graph, which is a study performed by using AI, an increase in ADR is strictly related to the increase in the number of diminutive polyps identified. And by consequence, costs related to removal and histopathology evaluation of those polyps is increasing, affecting the final cost of the entire procedure. As we know from previous studies, this is a study published by Cesare more than 10 years ago, if we are able to implement in our everyday clinical practice a resect and discard strategy, we can save money. We can perform our procedure with less costs. But before performing any kind of resect and discard strategy, first of all, we have to be able to predict the histology, accurately the histology of the polyp we are facing too. How we can do that? We know from many previous studies that the blue light, which is the base of both MBI and BLI, is the ideal light for polyp characterization, since this light is absorbed by vessels, and then we are able to really recognize very tiny superficial features of polyps, and particularly for BLI, it works together with the LED illumination, which is providing very, very bright images. As you can see in the next slide here, there is a polyp evaluated by HD white light and the same polyp evaluated by BLI. So in 2018, we planned a study in which we evaluated diminutive and small polyps by either HD white light or BLI. And we observed that by BLI, the accuracy we were able to reach in characterizing polyp was much higher compared to the accuracy we were able to reach characterizing those polyps by HD white light. And interestingly, this figure was also confirmed for diminutive polyps, as you can see here. Unfortunately, when we started this study, there was no available classification specifically based on BLI. So we were forced to use other classification, and we decided to translate criteria for NICE classification to BLI. But fortunately, later the same year, a group of experts came out with this new classification. Everybody knows about it. It is a Bayesian classification. It is characterized by three domains: polyp surface, peat appearance, and vessel patterns, together with some subdomains and their own descriptors. By validating this classification with a large library of images based on BLI, the experts were able to identify two, let's say, profiles, type A and type H. Type A stands for adenomas, and H stands for hyperplastic. They were able also to characterize poly by those two types of profiles, particularly as far as adenomas are concerned. They observed that the surface is characterized by known round pits and also by pericryptal vessels. Those two features are the determinants, the major determinants for classifying a polyp as an adenoma. Those polyps usually does not have a mucus on top. They tend to have an heterogeneous pit distribution. And interestingly, unfortunately, another feature which is not so common among diminutive polyp is the irregular surface. When there is a pseudodepression on the center of a polyp, this could be quite easily classified as an adenoma. Conversely, when we address hyperplastic polyp, those tend to be featureless, meaning that there are no specific features on top of the polyp. When pits are visible, those are generally round dark, and vessels are absent, or when they are present, they are generally very tiny and lazy. Those characteristics are typical of hyperplastic polyps. When we saw those characteristics, we can recognize the presence of hyperplastic polyps. We try to validate the same classification in clinical practice in real time by performing colonoscopy, and we observe that for diminutive polyps evaluated with high confidence, a very, very high level of accuracy by applying BLI through basic criteria. In the same study, we were also able to demonstrate that we were able to meet the PV1 statement, meaning that we were able to reach a negative predictive value for characterizing diminutive rectosigmoid polyp, reaching a negative predictive value of over 90%, which was 91.3% in that study. We were also able to meet the PV2 threshold because we were able to calculate correctly the post-polypectomy surveillance interval in more than 90% of our patients, according to both EU guideline and US guideline. All those data seems to suggest that this kind of light, this kind of classification are both ready for prime time. But as we know, there are some new things, that there are some new kits on the block, and recently some new techniques, some new intelligent algorithms have been developed, aimed at characterizing polyps in the colon and during colonoscopy. There are already many studies published on this topic, and we know that there are many other publications coming out on the same topic because this is a very hot topic. But when we look in detail to those studies, unfortunately, the majority of them have some limitations, some methodological limitation, because they are mostly focused on technical issues instead of on clinical issues. And also another main limitation is the fact that all those studies are working on still images, not on videos. They are working on high quality videos, but we know that in real time, in real practice, we are working in a real time setting with images which are not always so of high quality. Therefore, at best of my knowledge, there is only one study which is combining relevant clinical outcomes measurement and the real-time evaluation, the real-time characterization of polyps, which is this study. This has been published this year in Annals of Internal Medicine by Mori and colleagues. They were able to demonstrate that by using the real-time CAD they used in that study, they could achieve the performance level required for a diagnose and leading strategy for diminutive non-neoplastic rectosigmoid body. But once again, when we go in details, when we look the way in which they perform this kind of evaluation, we realize that this kind of evaluation was quite cumbersome, time-consuming, and let's say difficult to do. In fact, they combine endocytoscopy evaluation, endocytoscopy images, together with MBI or with methylene blue. So the real question is, does exist another technique which is able to do exactly the same kind of task in a quicker, easier way, or even in a way in which we can easily perform in our everyday practice? For that purposes, Fujifilm developed the CADI for polyp characterization. In the next few slides, we will see how this system works, how it looks like, particularly for those who are not so familiar with the system. As soon as we identify a polyp, a diminutive polyp like this one, for example, we activate the BLI as we do in our everyday practice. And by apply basic criteria, we can try to do our own characterization, which seems to be related to an adenomatous polyp in this case, because we see the crypts are quite elongated and also because there are pericryptal vessels. Then we can activate the system. As soon as we activate the system, a map appears on the lower right quadrant of our screen. This is a location map. And inside the location map, there is a dot colored dot. This is extremely important because this is the area of interest. It means that machine is focusing on that part of our screen. This is important because we have to focus on that to verify that our eyes are looking exactly at the same area that the machine is evaluating. Then there is also a gray bar, which is appearing on the right side of your image. This right bar is made by three gray segments. This is important because only when all those three segments are fully colored, as in this image here, the machine, from a technical point of view, already acquire enough amount of data to be able to provide his own characterization, which is highlighted by the presence of those yellow brackets. The code color yellow stands for neoplastic. The green color code stands for hyperplastic. And then a banner is appearing on the lower part of our screen. That way we can realize that this is a neoplastic polyp as it has been characterized by the machine. I guess that the next few slides, in which there are some show videos, could be much more explanatory and easy to understand than my previous presentation, because all those information are popping up all together on the screen, making the interpretation of CADI results quite easy. As you can see here, there is a polyp. We already activated the BLI, so we can try to do our own characterization, let's say again, by using basic criteria. Then we can activate the system. As you can see here, sorry for the little delay, there is a dot appearing in the center of our location map. There are three bars gray there. And then finally, we can characterize this polyp as a neoplastic. Here, there is another example. This is another polyp. We see this polyp with white light during withdrawal phase of our colonoscopy. Then we can activate first BLI, and then we can try to characterize this polyp, taking the CAD off. Then we can activate the CAD. As soon as we activate the system, a green mark, a green dot is appearing over there. We have to check to be sure that the target is exactly the same. That way, we are sure that we are characterizing exactly this area there, and this is an hyperplastic polyp. I have a third case. This is the third case. The third case is a little bit more tricky, more challenging. For us, the BLI is already activated. We can quite easily classify this polyp as an adenoma, but look what's happening when we activate the system. At the beginning, the machine seems to confirm our initial evaluation. This is a neoplastic polyp for the machine. But when the tip of the endoscope goes underwater, the characterization of these polyps change. Back inside the lumen, this is a neoplastic one. Back inside the water, this is an hyperplastic one. For the same polyp, you have two completely different outputs. That this is extremely important to know, because there are some tips and tricks we have to know when we use the system in order to maximize the capability of the system to evaluate polyps, to characterize those polyps. First of all, we have to remember that we are dealing with images. We are dealing with optical features. For that reason, we have to clean the lenses. We have to clean the polyp to be sure there are no debris, there are no anything stuck on the endoscope. Otherwise, there is something between the endoscope and the polyp. But as soon as we clean the lenses, we have also to remove the water, because when the polyp is seen underwater, it tends to be classified as an hyperplastic one. There are no obvious reason for that, but probably because the fluid inside the lumen is not completely transparent, there are some small debris, and those debris can cause a sort of blurry effect on top of the polyp. For that reason, probably the image is not so clear. It's difficult for the system to pick up tiny details of the surface, and for that reason, it tends to be classified as hyperplastic. We have also to remember to focus on the polyp, taking the polyp on a frontal view. This is important because when the polyp is on the side, the light is tangential. When the light is tangential, we have some reflection effects, some diffraction effects, and those effects can modify the way in which the polyp is perceived by the system, the way in which the polyp is evaluated by the system. We have to stabilize the scope, and I have to say also to stabilize the patient. Sometimes we have to ask the patient to hold the breath, for example, because movements of the scope or movements of the patient can create some halo effect. Those halo effects can be dangerous for polyp classification. Last but not least, we have to continuously check the position map to be sure that the target polyp is still the same, still remain the same. And the best way to do that is to keep the polyp centered in our screen. And then finally, please remember, if you use the system, to ask the BLI, the Fujifilm staff, because within the BLI setting, there are specific settings to be prepared for polyp characterization. Anyway, this system is just provide a suggestion to the endoscopist. Finally, the evaluation of the polyp is a combined process. We have to take into account the first initial evaluation of the endoscopist and the output from the machine. At present time, the final decision about the polyp still remains in the hands, in the eyes, in the brain of the endoscopist. This is finally a way in which we will probably perform our procedure in the near future by combining together CAD for detection and CAD for characterization. As you can see here, during withdrawing the scope on LCI, we can easily identify by the CAD detection the polyp. And then we can push on a button, activate the BLI, provide our own classification, our own characterization, and then look at the answer from the machine, which is characterizing this polyp as an hyperplastic one. As you can see here, when the polyp is on the side, there are some difficulties for the machine, but only when the polyp is in the center, close to the center of the target here, it is fully characterized as an hyperplastic one. Of course, there are still some open issues to be addressed. First of all, we talk about adenomatous polyp. We heard before Helmut talking about sessile-serrated lesions. This system right now is characterizing sessile-serrated lesion, as you can see in this short video here, as an hyperplastic polyp. This is mostly because superficial features of sessile-serrated lesions and superficial features of hyperplastic polyps tend to be closely similar. Probably the best way for defining polyps would be adenomatous polyps in one side and non-adenomatous polyps on the other side by combining together hyperplastic SSL lesions. Anyway, this could be no longer an issue since we are mostly focusing on diminutive polyps, since we are mostly focusing on left-sided polyp. And we know that among diminutive and left-sided polyps, the rate of CSI serrated lesion is very, very low. And the clinical value of those lesions is definitely less relevant than the lesions we observe in the right side of the column. It's extremely important to follow a training. It's extremely important to follow a learning curve. As for any other system for poly characterization, we have to reach some thresholds. We have to maintain our performances. We have to be checked periodically. We have to follow audits to be sure that we are doing exactly the task we would like to do, and we are able to maintain our performances over time. Scientific societies are supporting systems, any kind of system for poly characterization, only provided that the endoscopist is able to do that, only provided that the performances reached are maintained over time. On the other hand, using those systems without knowing what is behind that, without knowing basic classification, without knowing details on how to classify the polys, can lead to over-rely on the system, can be on the scaling, meaning we can lose our skills, we can lose our own capabilities in evaluating polyp if we rely only on the system. Last but not least, there are some cost effectiveness issues, some legal issues, which has to be addressed in the near future, and those issues can differ from country to country, so it could be evaluated locally. Before ending my presentation, I would like to thank all my colleagues which are working together with me in this characterization journey every day. Thank you so much for your attention.
Emanuele, I feel that you did great. It's never easy to talk after a great speaker like Helmut, but you did brilliant. Do you agree, Oliver?
Absolutely, yeah.
Thank you so much.
So, Emanuele, okay, so please, Oliver, you go.
No, I really very, very nice presentation. There's one question from the audience. So I think you partly already answered this, that those systems will really increase the numbers of polyps. And the panelists...
The system we already heard from Neumann, from Helmut, are still really increase the number of polyps we are identifying. This could help us in deciding which kind of polyp we have to take out and which kind of polyp we can leave in without...
Emanuele, wait, Oliver didn't complete the question yet.
Should we try to increase our skills to also characterize those polyps, because the patients will perhaps not trust an AI system alone? But I think you already answered this question, that we can't really just trust the system, and we should not lose our skills, or even we should try to increase our skills. I think that's very important.
Absolutely. Absolutely. The final decision is combined, taking into account both the endoscopist evaluation and the machine output.
Yeah. Okay, Emanuele first, and then I'm curious to know from Helmut. Okay, just imagine, okay, that I see a polyp and I say, oh, but this is adenoma, 100%. This is adenoma with all my confidence. I swear on my mother, no, better on my wife. Okay, so this is adenoma. Then I switch CAD-I and I go to BLI and CAD-I say, oh no, Cesare, you're very stupid. This is clearly an hyperplastic, and myself, CAD-I, is very confident on this. What should I do? Emanuele first and Helmut after, if there is a discordance between the two.
Okay, since I am the first, it's much easier. I would like to take this polyp out to send this polyp to the histopathology, because when I'm completely sure that the polyp is an adenoma and the machine is supporting my decision, I can decide that it's an adenoma, I can decide how to deal with it. When there is some sort of non-conclusive evaluation and when the machine is challenging my initial evaluation, I have to consider that could be an error over there and I could send the polyp to the histopathology for the histopathology evaluation.
I totally agree. So, Emanuele, fantastic presentation. The decision is always on us. And also, if you allow, very shortly, I want to comment because it's extremely important for the audience to recognize even the cat eye characterization. So for the ESGE clear, maybe you can go a little bit back on the presentation of Emanuele to the last video showing the hyperplastic polyp. And this was a fantastic, really fantastic examples you have shown to us, Emanuele, and fantastic results. Congratulations to the recent publication in Clinical Gastroenterology and Hepatology. It's a fantastic study, and I've seen it also a little bit before. Fantastic one. So, Cleo, can you go a little bit more back to the video, to this one? I feel okay. This is the video, and maybe if you run the video, and can you give me control of the mouse wheel? Oh, that's good. Ah, thank you. So, because now it's very important for you to see, now we are characterizing the polyp here with a cat eye characterization mode and following to BLI. And then sometimes you see the polyp is recognized as hyperplastic. And then this is also that you see, oh, then sometimes it's called neoplastic, is it? And then you might feel, oh, there is a little bit disturbance, but you have to look at those bars here on the right side. And this is the status of the decision. So only when all the three bars are raised, then the decision is made if it's an hyperplastic one or not. So it's very important for us not to look at this one, but really to look at the lower one and even on the decision bar. So only when the decision bar is showing all the three parts, then the computer really makes a final decision. So you can see, although, for example, in this part, the computer is saying this is neoplastic, but you can see we do not get any result here. And also the decision bar is extremely low. So we are not doing our decision and the characterization with this target image here. This only shows us where the polyp is, but we are looking at the decision bar, and then finally you will see when the decision is made for hyperplasia, then the computer is 100% safe.
And sure. This is very important because the computer makes the diagnosis at any frame, but as you are now stressing, only when the diagnosis is extremely confident, this means polyp at the center, when the focus is maximum, completely clean, and the three bars are all green or yellow, you receive the diagnosis of the machine. But then, Oliver, you must interpret the diagnosis, because at the end, you need to put it in the report. Now, Oliver, imagine that tomorrow you are scoping with the CAD eye and you identify, for instance, an hyperplastic polyp in the rectus sigmoid. Would you already put in your report, this is a 3 millimeter hyperplastic polyp as defined by CAD eye, or would you put the picture with the CAD eye in the report? How would you implement your practice, the characterization mode? In my view, it's more difficult.
Yeah, so I would of course put in the pictures into the record, and I would only put in the characterization I made, perhaps with the support of the the cat eye. But when it's not conclusive, I would just put in the my diagnosis and not that one of the cat eye. So it's always us who make the decision.
Okay, Helmut, there is a question from the audience. Just 1 second, Emanuele. That I feel it's very clever. Imagine that you are starting colonoscopy right now. You're starting the training in colonoscopy right now, okay? I never did the colonoscopy, okay? Should I do my first colonoscopy with or without a CAD eye for detection? Helmut, then Oliver and Emanuele.
Well, I think this is a very, very exciting question, and we can interpret from both sides. I really like the question very much. Coming back to cars, so you know, so it's not only about navigation. Yeah, Germany, you know, so cars, yeah, it's our passion, Oliver, is it? But it's we talked about navigation system, but the same is: are you using automatic system or are you using manual system? So when you start driving, should you start with manual system or automatic system? So the idea is that you should start with manual, because when you start with automatic, you will be not able to use the manual system later on. Mm-hmm. However, manual, automatic is the way maybe to go. So yeah, when you exactly. decide in the future we will only drive automatic cars, why should you then learn the manual thing? I feel it is really very much dependent on the training situation, even on the availability in your individual countries. I would say when you're really at a very high level center, which is really using the latest equipment, then honestly, I would not see any problem in starting with AI. Because you will use it later on as well, always, because this should be the way to go. But again, the question is fantastic, and we still need to learn. Yeah. But again, I feel it's depending on the individual countries and the centers maybe, and maybe even the ESGEs, Cesare. But I'm pretty sure you're already working on it. Yeah, can provide some good ideas for us how we should act on this.
Let's listen from Oliver. Because the same will apply, Oliver, to Barrett. Will you start a trainee with the CAD-E for high-grade displays in Barrett, or would you just go for?
So without? Perhaps in Barrett it's a little bit easier, because then you can start to try to find the lesion without a CAD-I system, and then you can switch on and see what the system looks. So you can learn from the system, or this might be something, it's easier for that, for Barrett's, than it's for a Coulomb, because when you have to decide whether you switch on for detection or not. And I would start training with the CAD-I system, because also the endoscopists can learn from this, and it can help the young endoscopists to detect those lesions easier. That's my impression. That's what I do with
very
my...
good point, Oliver. Emanuele, is there a learning effect by CAD-I? Can we already say that, or we need to wait for more evidence, and then we need to move to the last presentation?
Yes, we have to wait for the new data, but as soon as we know for the data we have already, there is a learning effect. We can learn how to use the system, how to maximize the system, how to the system is working. So we need training, we need to build up our own learning curve. At the beginning of my personal experience, I was sometimes astonished by the fact that I was not able to work exactly, and the system was not answering all my questions. Right now, which I'm using the system since a few months, is much easier. It's much easier, much quicker, and the system is improving. Not because the system is improving, because the system is the same. I'm improving using the system.
That's good. Thanks, Emanuele. Helmut,
thank you.
Oliver, go to the last one.
Okay, so the last talk in our webinar is about pure stuff. So we come from AI and go to pure stuff. It's a new gel that helps to stop bleeding or prevent bleeding after interventions. And Jochen Weigt from Germany will give us a talk about this very exciting new technology. So Jochen, please.
Okay. First of all, thank you for the kind invitation. Fujifilm for the invitation, ESGE for hosting, very interesting. I would give a comment to the last question, if you allow, because I think you should never do a colonoscopy alone if you are a beginner. And there are circumstances in which you have to judge whether there is a neoplasia or not, also outside cancer screening. So you have patients with chronic inflammatory bowel disease that might have some lesions, and you still have to judge there. And there is maybe not the place to use the AI. So you always have to rely on yourself. So now we come to the topic I have to talk about. I like to talk about Purestat, from basics to clinical use. And I want to explain how it comes from the molecule to the clinical use in this interesting substance. Now I take over here. This is something I usually like to hide, but you can read this. I go over this very quickly. I will highlight some issues. What is Purestat exactly? How does it act? What is the other potential outside endoscopic use in medicine in general? And then highlight the use in endoscopy, also giving you some cases that I did with Purestat. If we talk about Purestat, you always heard this is a self-assembling molecule. So just to highlight what this self-assembling is like, I just tried to give you an overview. You know that proteins and peptides are built from amino acids. And these amino acids, they build change. This is what we call the primary structure. And this primary structure goes into a secondary structure, either forming these alpha helices or into very stable beta platelet sheets. So these beta platelet sheets, this is what we need to have a look on, because Pyrostat consists of the peptide called RADR 16. RADR is nothing else than the repetitive order of arginine, alanine, aspartic acid, and alanine again in a four times order, meaning RADA, 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 and then there comes the turn in this beta sheet, and then it goes back again, and so on, forming on and on and on these large beta sheets. So if you have four amino acids, you can have one of these RADA molecules. If you have four, you have one curve. Then these beta sheets form. They already look like these small tubes. These small tubes, they connect to larger nets with these filaments here, and they form a matrix which is very similar to the extracellular matrix that we know from histology. And this is what all happens inside this drop of Pyrostat if you pour it on any body liquid. So the self-assembling itself happens, or is it used by a change in pH? So this is what physics and chemistry means. But if you break it down to the human body, it's equal to the contact of body fluids. So in the moment that you put the Pyrostat gel on your bleeding site or on the mucosa, it starts self-assembling, and it takes about 30 to 60 seconds until this network is completely done, and then it is pretty stable. So the use in medicine in endoscopy is mainly haemostasis, but however, the original development was done for CNS regeneration experiments. However, now in the moment, the only way you should not use it is a use in CNS. So you can use it everywhere in the body outside the central nervous system. I will first highlight the role in tissue healing. This is a pretty old experiment. So this is from 2008, where scientists did a artificial scarring, so a wound inside one of these measuring chambers. And they put on this extracellular matrix-like gel, which included RADA, 16 molecules, and added EGFR, so an epithelium growth factor, and looked where they should place it and how it should be placed to provoke wound healing and EGF expression from this matrix. And what they found was very astonishing, because they found that with this gel, the wounds healed much faster, and the release of this epidermal growth factor was only visible in case the gel, like here in this picture, had contact to the epithelium cells itself. So if you put the drop in the middle, like very small here, there was, and this is really hard to see, these dots here, completely no release of EGF into the subarachnoid in this experiment, meaning there is something like a crosstalk and interaction between this extracellular matrix like web from these RADA molecules and the cells. Very natural appearance. Other actions have also been investigated, like drug release of growth factors, different types, chemotherapeutic agents. So I found a study about oxaliplatin gels, tissue engineering, most of bone, skin, and cartilage healing, so things that are very important for body stability. But you can use it also in the laboratory, because it is also applicable for 3D cell cultures, which is a very fancy thing to do cell-cell interaction experiments in the moment, and mainly for wound healing, especially in burn patients, so patients that have large wounds on their bodies. So, but now I will come to the endoscopic application of Pyrostat, and they have recently been two studies published. One is from Northern Italy, from Milano here, and the other one is from Portsmouth. I will show this later. This first trial observed 77 patients with bleeding. Most of them had the bleeding as a complication of an intervention, meaning of endoscopic resection. Some of them during intervention, most of them as a delayed bleeding. Most of them were smaller ones, so oozing bleeding. Some of them, so the minority, were spurting. And Pyrostat in this study was used as a rescue therapy after failure of at least two hemostatic procedures. So they started in normal manner, meaning clips, coagulation, injection, and so on. And only if this was not healing or stopping the bleeding, they should switch to Pyrostat. The results of this trial showed with a mean of 2.6 haemostatic failures, how difficult it sometimes is, especially during the resections, to get the bleeding stopped. Successful haemostasis was achieved in 90.9%, meaning you had an initial control. However, 41 patients had an additional haemostatic control, and afterwards they need another procedure. But re-bleeding rate here, as you can see, with this only 8 patients, so 10%, only had re-bleeding. In the case of intra-procedural bleeding, and this is very interesting because it's pointing me to the next study, all the interventions could be completed. So there was no need to stop the intervention, leaving hundreds of clips inside just because there was a bleeding. All the early cancers or neoplastic lesions could be removed. And in total, no adverse event, like the next study, was or were seen. And this brings me to the conclusions. Pure study is feasible in this way. It was safe and effective in controlling different types. So there were also some ulcers included, different types of GI hemorrhage after the failure of conventional haemostatic methods. So meaning you can still go on, use your electrocoagulation device or clips or injection. And if it doesn't work, you can change to Curestat. And during a resection, you can go on. So meaning you put it on, it stays clear, and you don't have to change anything. It doesn't hinder you continuing and ending the endotherapy. And this brings me to the next study from Portsmouth, where they investigated 100 cases where they did endoscopic resections. EMR, hybrid ESD, so larger ones in the rectum especially, and ESD mostly in the esophagus and in the stomach. And in this study, they did it the other way around. They used Curestat as a primary haemostatic method and cautery in addition. So the other way around is most of you would use it, I think. And at the end, all the resection planes were covered or smeared with Curestat. The next video will show you how I do it. So this is a, we'll start an ESD of an early cancer at the pylorus. And you know, in the pylorus region, you sometimes have to struggle with these strong submucosal veins here. It already stopped almost in the ending. You bring up this Curestat. So you have it in the catheter. You steer this catheter with moving your endoscope like you do maybe with a polypectomy snare and other devices. And then you just pour it on the surface and it is kind of sticky. And inside these lips here of the normal mucosa, it stays inside. Then you wait a little bit that it can self-aggregate and then you can leave this place alone. The efficacy of Curestat in this study was very high. No additional haemostatic method was needed in over 70% if it was a grade 1 or 2, so a venous type bleeding of low activity, but only 50%, so 3 or 6, of spurting stronger bleedings. However, this was not significant in this way. However, only 3 delayed bleedings occurred from this 100 patients, so 3% of rebleeding, and 2 of them with ESD at an early anticoagulation started again. So these 3 patients had a good cause for early bleeding the next and the very next day after resection. So in conclusion, Curestat can effectively be used during endoscopic resections. And as you see, it is clear you can end your endoscopic resection because it doesn't cover your resection plane and your view to the submucosal tissue. And it may have, I have to be very restrictive, it may have an impact on re-bleeding after endoscopic resection. So this 3 out of 100 cases sounds very low, but as there is no direct comparative trial, I just have to point out that we are not really sure how big the rate of delayed bleeding after ESD is. So the range in literature is tenfold. So from 1.3 to 13% in this recent review study. So it may be in between here, but there should be a direct comparison in between some methods. So to point out once again, the advantages, as you can see, you put it on the mucosa, you have a clear vision because even after assembling, it is a transparent gel. So your procedure can go on. It has no side effects. It is extremely easy to use. I will show you. I do it on my own, so I don't even need the nurse to administer. Sorry for all the nurses that are watching and listening. and it can be combined with other hemostatic procedures. And the way you do it, you decide. You can use it first, and if it's not working, you can still do electrocautery, or if you start with electrocautery, you can still use the pyrostat gel. So I will present you three cases in total, and then I come to an end. The first one is a bleeding Pech tube. I always think bleeding Pech tubes are complicated because you don't know where the bleeding's originating from. Is it coming from the mucosa? Is it coming from submucosal tissue? Is it coming from the abdominal cavity or even from the abdominal wall? The second one is a papillary bleeding after sphincterotomy in case of a juxtapapillary diverticle. Usually the EST is done very early during ERCP, so you need to go on with your interventions usually. So you should have something that is reliable and you can see through, and this is what Pyrostat can offer to you. And if you think about clipping and injecting, sometimes it's not the right place. And especially if you think about pancreatic duct closure, a stent at the papilla is not really an option. And the third case is an anastomotic bleeding after a gastric pull-up procedure at the fifth day, so very, very early. So if you think about injecting epinephrine solution, you might risk ischemia. Or if you think about, oh, it's easy, I just put in an over-the-scope clip, you might be right, but there is a risk of stricture later, and these are sometimes very difficult to therapy. So the first case is a bleeding Pech tube. You see, you rinse it with water. You can be sure there is a bleeding. You cannot remove this clot completely here. So we try to do with epinephrine solution, but there's still some bleeding going on here, and this is how you do it. You go very, very close. You put the catheter directly on the surface and then you squeeze the syringe with the other hand, or the nurse can do it also, over the surface, and then you can also smear it a little bit. So by moving the catheter through these laps. What you can do in addition is, I just remembered what the worker of 3D Matrix told me, you can use it everywhere in the body. So I decided just to put it inside this channel in the orifice because there was blood still coming out there and it stopped. The patient did not come back for his luck. So we were successfully treating this bleeding. This is a typical Friday afternoon. Just remove the stone from the old lady, but then you have this juxtapapillary diverticulum. The anatomy of the papilla is not completely clear. You see a heavy bleeding. I managed to put in a stent very quickly and then try to stop here. But you see, even application with a side viewing endoscope is not very difficult because it's pretty sticky to the surface. And what you can also do, you have the clear vision. You can still find the papilla if you desire to. And the third case is the case with the anastomotic bleeding. You see here at the side, I removed some clots. The stable was rather stable after this surgery. And then you look, where is gravity carrying you? You just turn the endoscope so that you can work with direct contact without losing your direction of view. And then you make one bleb beside the other, just like in submucosal injection, one bleb finds the other one, and then they unite, and then you have a complete net of these self-assembling peptides all over your wound, and you see it happens really fast that you do not have any more bleeding. And also this patient did not come back to endoscopy unit and did well. So I come to an end. I'm a little bit faster than allowed. My take-home message is clear. Pyrostat consists of self-assembling peptides. I think I have explained to you the basics of how this self-assembling takes place. It has a matrix-like appearance. And matrix, to me, is like it really is very similar to the extracellular matrix of the human body. And therefore, it could be used for tissue healing and also carrying some drugs to certain points, so a transporter. But in endoscopy, it's mainly used for hemostasis. It is extremely easy to use. It is highly effective in my experience, and also the data show this. It is non-toxic, and what is a major advantage, if you apply it to the surface, it stays transparent. And if you compare this in your mind to other competitors, you know what I'm talking about. This is a real advantage that you can go on working. However, I only showed you a few data because there are only a few data available and we definitely need more data. But I know that the company and scientists are working ongoing, especially on aortic and vascular surgery. GI bleeding is a large topic and liver surgery especially. And there I come to an end, and thank you for your invitation.
Great presentation, Jochen. And there were a lot of questions. For instance, is there any risk for the scope when you use Purastat? Can you use for bleeding varices, or can you use as a lifting solution for ESD?
Well, these are questions that are always coming up. So the first thing is there is absolutely no hazard for your endoscope. So it doesn't become any like sticky or like glue, or if you think about acryl injection, so histoacryl, you don't have any hazards. You just put it on the surface. In general, it is an interesting question if it comes to submucosal injection for ESD, because there have been these gels for autodissection. You know, from Cook Medical, they have a patent on this. You squeeze it in the submucosal tissue, but however, this gel is very, very viscous. I think it will be very, very complicated to put this into a needle into the submucosal. So maybe you need an applicator for this. But I don't know if it really can prevent bleeding, because I think this question is aiming towards, can it prevent bleeding if I put it in the tissue before I cut into the vessel? And this is something that I cannot answer, because I think if you inject it, it will polymerize and maybe then the effect is gone. So I will not in the moment suggest to put it inside the submucosal space.
Oliver, any point from you?
Yeah, I think it was very, very nice talk, and especially the your small videos showing the use it in the daily practice are very, very, very impressive. So several people ask where you can buy it. So is it available? And if yes, where can you get it from?
So it is available, I guess, almost everywhere in the world. So in Germany, we have a partner. So 3D Metric is not selling it by itself. But if you go to the homepage, I just stopped it today. You can see who's responsible for your selling and vending it. So it shouldn't be a problem to get it. The CE mark is done, so you don't have to worry just to use it. We started using it in 5 milliliter portions because it felt very good, but you don't need it. So there are smaller ones like 3 and 1 millimeter. And meanwhile, we switched to 3 milliliters, which is even less expensive. So I advise buying 3 milliliters, and this is absolutely enough for everything, I would say.
Does it work for varices?
I didn't test it, but I don't believe in this. And I haven't read anything about this. So I think it will not be enough. I think the flow outside this vein is too hard, and it will wash away this gel, I suggest.
And then an arterial also bleeding? I think it's too
maybe in another dimension. I mean, because you mean if you have a bleeding, you inject, you clip, you do everything, and you have this little bit activity at the side sometimes, and you do not trust it, what do you do? You leave it, you go home, or you send it to the radiologist, or if you want to sleep well, maybe then you can add Purastat and hope that there is a little bit more coverage even in between the branches of a clip, maybe. I don't really know. We need this data.
Okay. Any experience with fistulas?
Oh, no, we never tried this. But what we tried is to bring ulcers to healing, and there is also one publication published as an abstract, where they tried to influence radiation proctitis, and that was very successful indeed. Mm-hmm. So there seems to be an influence on healing in the pure status. So you put it in without any other drugs inside there, and there seems to be an influence of wound healing.
Mm-hmm. Good. Oliver, I feel that we did very interesting stuff, but now it is time to close probably. So I guess that we need to thank our amazing, outstanding speakers. And I guess that we must pay tribute to Fujifilm for having integrated CAD-i in the Eruxeo family. Artificial intelligence is not for the future. It's a revolution. We are sitting on the edge of it. It's here. It's with us. It's in our platform. So, Oliver, I feel a lot of things will come.
Yeah, absolutely. Totally agree. I think we are at the beginning of a new era in endoscopy. Yeah, it's really groundbreaking. Absolutely.
Okay, so thanks. Sorry.
So also thank you. Great speakers. Was a really a great webinar, great session. And thank you very much. And from my side, to you and the audience, have a very nice evening.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you very much.
Ciao. Bye.